there is what is the potential for artificial intelligence and what would be the acceptance of artificial intelligence. You know, humans, kind of as a species, aren't very flexible about giving up their concept of autonomy and power. How much would we be willing to turn over? My name is Marty Kohn. I'm a physician and engineer, a health policy analyst, and I am a chief medical scientist for care delivery systems and IBM research. In that role, I work in developing and supporting the implementation of analytic tools to help manage and use data in healthcare to make better decisions. We're accustomed to having artificial intelligence and computerized systems fly airplanes, you know, right down to landing. There's a certain repetitiveness or routineness in that, or standardness in that, that makes that seem acceptable. There may be some decisions about patients that can be routine, and maybe a large number of them, because we do recognize that a lot of what physicians do were things that other people could have done just as well, so it's reasonable to conceive that an artificial intelligence system could manage some of these things too. Some kinds of decisions, I'm not sure. You know, when I interact with the patient, there's something about that personal interaction, that part that leads into the decision-making process. For instance, Watson is given information from, you know, about the patient, but Watson, you know, is not able to tell, you know, if when I speak to a patient, you know, do I get a sense that the patient doesn't understand my question or is misrepresenting things either intentionally or unintentionally, or saying things because she, you know, he or she thinks I want to hear that. I used to read a great deal of science fiction, and, you know, roughly divided science fiction into two categories, the apocalyptic kind of end of the world science fiction, and the science fiction that I thought represented man's vision of what they wanted for the future. And if you look at some of that, and let's take Star Trek as an example, the physicians in Star Trek have incredibly sophisticated devices because they have to deal with, you know, different species, you know, and collect information. But the final decision is made by the physicians. How would you teach a machine compassion? I'm not sure. My interaction with the patient, I don't think should go away, and I don't think will go away. There is a huge amount of information that's available to us that is beyond the human eye, brain, and ear to appreciate and process. Using that information would help us make better decisions. Using more detailed information to personalize healthcare, to be able to address you as an individual, I think it has great value. You know, there are people who fear it because, you know, if you learn all this information about me, will you use it against me? Will the insurance company refuse to insure me? So we have this balance of kind of what is the social imperative to take care of people versus the fear based on past experience that if somebody learns too much about you, it can be used to harm you. Now, there are people who disagree. I view our analytic tools that we're developing as helping people make better decisions. The knowledgeable, empowered patient. 30 years ago, healthcare was, you know, it's a pretty paternalistic model, or avuncular model. You know, I'm the physician, I know everything, you know nothing. I'm going to tell you what to do, and you will do it because I told you to do so. Okay. And obviously, compliance to that was pretty poor because it's dictated, it's not personalized, it's not motivated. With some of these educational tools to help you know more about yourself, it's not just being told what to do, but you're actively participating in the decision making. You understand the implications, you know what you can do to be better and how much better your life will be if you do these things. So for example, you know, I travel a lot working for IBM, so my physician can say, I want you to have this exercise program and this diet. And I can say, hey doc, we need to come up with a plan that, you know, may not be the A1 plan, but we'll get a lot of what we want done. My initial education was at MIT in electrical engineering. One of the things I had noticed with my medical education as compared to engineering is it was very much emphasizing on rote knowledge. System concepts of critical thinking were really not part of medical education. Experienced physicians do use kind of implicitly some system thinking or even pattern recognition techniques, which we might call experience, in making their decisions. But there are only certain kinds of information, certain amounts of information that a human brain can process. I guess what I would hope is, you know, right now I get the sense that some very important decisions are made without very good information, or based on biases or assumptions. Even if we look at the narrow focus of healthcare, we can provide all these analytic tools. But if you don't have the fundamental behavior change to the idea of, you know, I want healthcare to be more personalized and focused on outcomes. If we stay in the current model where most healthcare providers are rewarded for each unit of service, whether or not it's relevant, and healthcare organizations haven't made the change to being more personalized, outcome-based, and efficient, then the analytic tools aren't going to help us. We need that social behavioral adoption of the commitment to change before anything can help. And I just hope that, you know, the first few times we see the benefit of, you know, using evidence rather than bias in making decisions, maybe that will precipitate an avalanche. But I have more optimism than confidence.